You're listening to the audio production of Not a Hopeless Case, Six Vital Questions from Young Adults for a Church in Crisis by Halee Gray Scott, published by Zondervan and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com. Not a Hopeless Case, Six Vital Questions from Young Adults for a Church in Crisis. To Paul, my husband, my anchor in the storm, nothing would have been possible without your steady, strong presence in my life. Preface. I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it, I see everything else. C.S. Lewis, The Weight of Glory. There was a time when I believed the great American idea that your autobiography is your own personal story. Now, after years of exposure to a rich variety of people, customs, and traditions, I realize that our personal stories are inextricably linked to the stories of our fathers, our mothers, and the people of our cultures. For better or for worse, much of who we are depends on where we came from. For more than 100 years, most of the members of my family were cotton farmers, people of the earth who had left the luxuries of Western Europe to try their hand in a new land. They had enough courage to traverse the Atlantic and half of the continental United States territory in search of a better life. They had enough grit and determination to prevail through both the Great Depression and the Dust Bowl of Oklahoma. They were a pragmatic, hardworking lot of people who seemed to give little thought to their relationship with God. Jesus was reserved for Sundays, right along with fried chicken, sweet corn on the cob, and creamy mashed potatoes smothered with thick gravy. Their religion had little to do with daily life on the cotton farm. For much of my life, I believed my ancestors were pragmatically irreligious, too preoccupied with carving a life from the dry, hard earth of West Texas to be concerned with spiritual matters. But recently, in the summer of 2022, I learned from my grandmother that my ancestors' lack of spiritual practice was not because they didn't want to go to church. There was simply no church to go to in the small pioneer town. Once my great-grandfather had rooted out the stubborn mesquite trees, planted rows of cotton, and built a house, and my great-grandmother had stewarded the fields, raised her chickens, and planted her gardens, they turned their attention to building the first Christian church in Leveland, Texas. Yet even then, there was no discussion of a personal, life-changing relationship with Jesus. My family story is not unique among the families that have populated the southern regions of the United States up until the 21st century. For those with Jesus and fried chicken faith, being a Christian meant attending church on Sundays and sometimes praying before meals. Christianity did not involve a transformation or a growing intimate relationship with God. This is the family and the culture in which I was born and raised. And my spiritual journey is a sun-dappled story of how a very real, omnipresent God broke through those false ideas and brought healing to the damage they had caused. When I was a young girl, my nanny called me the preacher because I always talked about Jesus and tried to apply scripture to our circumstances. On the way to my great-grandmother's funeral at 4 years of age, I sensed the somberness of my family. From the back seat, I said brightly, "This is the day the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it." I remember Nanny and Papa looking back at me, not quite sure what to make of me. In the bathroom of the elementary school playground, a girl named Tasha whacked me across the face. I do not remember why, but I most likely deserved it. For a moment, I stared at her, debating whether to punch back. Instead, I surprised us both, and turning the other cheek toward her, said, "You hit that cheek, hit this one too." This left her flummoxed, and she fled in the opposite direction. The point is this: I loved Jesus. I loved his words, who he was, and how he treated others. I desperately, desperately wanted to be like him. Then I grew older, and cracks appeared in my parents' marriage. After their divorce, the people at our Baptist church no longer spoke to us. At 13, I resented this. I resented the treatment we received from people who said they believed in God. I resented the leaders who did not emulate Christ. Their actions spoke so loud I could not hear a word they said. And so, effectively banished from the family of faith, I drifted into the darkness, embracing a seething atheism and then the casual indifference of agnosticism. I sought transcendence in the euphoria of marijuana, in the company of friends, in books, in education, in late college nights around a campfire. I found, ultimately, only emptiness, sorrow, and profound darkness. As the poet Francis Thompson describes, I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinth ways of my own mind, and in the midst of tears, I hid from him and under running laughter. But the hound of heaven haunted me, breaking into the black night in which I had cloaked myself. I came to believe that the story was true, and that unbelief demanded more faith than Christianity. The proof was the hollow wreckage of my life. On my 21st birthday, at 2 a.m., after a long shift waiting tables at Applebee's, as the rain drizzled down the windshield of my Nissan Sentra, I committed my life again to Jesus in the parking lot of my apartment complex. Not long after, I was raped by the youth pastor at my church, where I had served on the youth team for the moment I rededicated my life to Christ. I have extensively detailed the experience elsewhere and do not wish to revisit the story here. Suffice it to say, broken, abused by a person of the clergy, I was faced with a series of questions. Did I believe God was good even after all this? Did I even believe in a God at all? And if so, how would I continue to serve him when I could not enter the doors of a church without breaking apart with crippling anxiety? Luckily, blessedly, I found work at a Christian nonprofit and there found a fellowship of believers who surrounded me and comforted me, even if they did not know why I needed safety and comfort. During this period, I attended regular meetings with a biblical counselor. Apart from the trauma of the assault, the shame of my life choices choked my soul like purple clematis chokes a trellis. Like Nathaniel Hawthorne's Hester Prynne, I felt as though I carried all my sin on the outside, visible for all to see. The weight of my shame was so great, I wanted to give up, give in. As I told the counselor my life story, I cast myself as the villain in every scenario. I wanted her to tell me I was a hopeless case, but she did not. She simply said, "My dear child, God must love you so much." Her response was so disarming that in time I decided that despite it all, I did believe that God was good. No, I was convicted of the fact. I was equally convicted I ought to spend my life ensuring, to the best of my ability, that what happened to me would not happen to others. I would not let people languish in darkness as I had. I would not let people believe they are hopeless cases. I would not let people be turned away from the faith because of the behavior of Christian leaders. As lofty and out of my control of those goals might have been, they were my only path forward, my only way to go on. And so, thanks to the unwavering support of my husband, Paul, I pursued an MA in religion at Azusa Pacific University and ultimately studied leadership and spiritual formation at Talbot School of Theology. At 27, I began teaching undergraduate courses at Azusa Pacific University, always feeling somewhat of an imposter. That feeling was amplified when, at 31 and 6 months pregnant with my daughter Ellie, I taught my first graduate course, Church and Society. Nearly all of my 30 students were older than me. One African-American man had ministered in South Central Los Angeles longer than I had been alive. The first night of class, he challenged me on every point. The second night, I shared my testimony, and that man became my biggest ally. That is when I learned there are two types of authority. The authority we receive from positions, training, degrees, or street cred, and the authority we get from lived experience. When I was growing up, my dad would laugh and say, "Halee, you ask too many questions." And so I parlayed that skill into journalism and eventually sociological research. Though I still teach graduate courses today, research, the asking of questions, is my deepest vocational love. Objectivity is the goal of every researcher worth their salt. And throughout my tenure as a researcher, I have put this goal ever before me. However, I cannot be divided from my story any more than my story can be divided from those who came before me. So this book is written on the foundation of two types of authority: my training as a researcher and my lived experience. For I, too, once was a nun, a no way, a no how, and absolutely not. Their questions were once my questions. It was the surprise of my life when, during the course of this research, I discovered I was far from alone. I understand the questions of young adults. We ignore them not just at our own peril, but at the peril of the souls who dwell in the darkness. When we turn deaf ears to the critiques, when we focus on numerical growth rather than spiritual growth, when we become desensitized to the central message and calling of Jesus, when we experience fragmentation in the church over issues of gender, worship, service, and textual interpretation, we risk reducing our faith to a Jesus and fried chicken faith. With Jesus, there is no and. There is only Jesus, the dusty-footed, itinerant preacher who ushered in a revolution in the way we understand and relate to God. May we bring the person and character of Christ to bear on the questions of our time. Acknowledgments. This book was born of the labor and love of many. First, I'd like to thank Betsy Nesbitt Wagner, my friend, colleague, fellow dreamer, and strategist. You're one of a kind, my friend, and I am so grateful for your support and guidance. Second, this project would not be possible without the team of researchers who lived into the stories of the churches and young adults: Ryan Beerwinkle, Reed Burvick, Jonathan Carr, Cole Comstock, Vonday Donaldson, Hunter Hambrick, Elizabeth Klempt, Taylor Miskell, Brian Moore, Victoria Mosco, Carla Valencia, and Christopher Wynn. You all are so gifted, so intelligent, and I am so honored to have had the opportunity to work with you and learn from you. Third, many other people from Denver Seminary provided valuable support throughout the tenure of this project, including Mark Young, Wendy Going, Mary Rivera, Mary Haskins, and Pam Dill. Finally, I would like to thank my family. Dad, thank you for fielding all the many questions I posed when I was young. You gave me the freedom to ask questions and seek answers, and I use those skills today. Eliana and Vivi, my daughters, thank you for your curiosity, your wisdom, and your company. I'm so proud of the young women you are becoming. Paul, as always, thank you for your strong and steady presence in my life. Part 1. What, how, who, when. Chapter 1. The what. Embracing the power of a question. It is easier to judge the mind of a man by his questions rather than his answers. Pierre-Marc Gaston de Levy Maxims and Reflections.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.